Yeah, thank you. Now we're on the second phase of our trip. I hope you got a lot of rest. We gave you plenty of time to get some rest because now we're going to step it up. You got a good night's sleep. I hope you enjoyed it. So day six, we're going to have, that's today, we're going to have an evening trip at Luxor, or the temple, ancient name was called Ipet Wissut. And then day seven, we're going to have a morning trip to the Baba, Grand Baba of all the temples, as is called Karnak today. As our ancestors called it Ipet Isut, the most sacred and holy of places. And this lecture is going to involve the two temples and what took place there, and all of the spiritual connections that led into many things into the Western world, although none of the things are mentioned, the fact that this is where many ideas came from here. And that's what our mission is. That's what our job is to reveal that information to you, brothers and sisters. In terms of the priests and the temples, it's one thing, as many, many tours I said before, they walk in here, they see the temples, then they go lay out by the pool and all that, and that's it. You know, there's no real significance or connection to the fact that the Western world actually took from here to make up many of the things that we know today in terms of the religions of Judaism, Christianity, Islam, many of the fraternal orders, the Masonic orders, and so forth. But this is, for the most part, unknown. This is the northeastern corner of Africa, the land of Kemet that is called Egypt today. Now, when we came in, we took our journey. Now we're in the southern part of Waset that is called Thebes by the Greeks. These were the spiritual centers that hundreds of years later, if not thousands of years, in fact, thousands of years later, that the Greeks came in and plundered these sacred sites of Waset. You're going to see a lot here. And what you're going to see here are the East Bank temples. And these are the temples of the Perha, or the temples that were built, okay, for our ancestors' educational system, or the Neterhet, or the divine house. The temple is in ruins today, the great temple dedicated to Amun. It was called the Abud of Ra, the Eye of Ra, the most spiritual center that our ancestors acknowledged. It was called the Cities of Cities. And I think that we have to quote the great grandmaster teacher, peace be upon him, ancestor Chancellor Williams, Dr. Chancellor Williams, who pointed out, if we as an African people today want to measure the distance to the height from which we have fallen, we need go no farther than the great city of Waset. Waset was called the mother of cities. Many of the sultans, okay, also called Nesu, or kings as we say today, were involved in building onto this temple, started in the Middle Kingdom over 4,000 years ago. It was during the Middle Kingdom of the African Amenhotep I, 1997 to 1971 BCE of the 12th Dynasty. These are the Wasetians in the southern part who built onto Ipet Assut to honor Amun. You always know the spiritual deity at this time because Amun is always in her name, like Amenhotep. He honored Amun by setting up this city, Amun the Nesu Neteru, the king of the spiritual Neterus. Early monotheism starting right here. You see the black deity, the black god of Waset, representing where the origin of Amun came from, is from the Kushites that we'll deal with when we get into our Nubian lecture. Honored here because this is the daughter of the Kushites. Nesu Neteru, Amun. That's what this temple was dedicated to, Amun, at this time, brothers and sisters. And then when Ner-Peri-Rahmose I defeated the Hyksos, there he made this the center of Kemet, the capital of Kemet at this time. It's no longer Menefer. Here he made Waset. And this spiritual center dedicated to Amun Ipet Assut, this was the spiritual center around 1500 BCE with this African who defeated the Hyksos. Ma'at Ra Septepen Rabba Mesu Murray Amun of the 19th Dynasty, 1298 to 1232 BCE. He is the one that built more onto all the temples than any other Sutan during this time of the 19th Dynasty. The last African, the Kushite African, Taharqa of the 25th Dynasty, around 690 to 664 BCE, who built the front pylon. The temple is made up of what our ancestors called in the Per and Meru, the Book of the Pylons. Because here, when I mentioned just Taharqa, the first pylon, okay, that tells the story is the pylon of Taharqa of the 25th Dynasty. The second one is a Ramesu. So you're walking in a book, brothers and sisters. That's what you're literally doing. And these are various ages from the 25th Dynasty, starting from ending with that period, but going back in time. So when you go into the temple, you're going back in time. You're going back in like a time capsule. It's like And you pick up a book and you turn the pages and you're reading one chapter, another chapter. You're in the chapters now. You're going through the pylon now. You're walking in the book now. So the temple was called the books of the pylon too, because just like you saw the pyramid text, and just like we see the scrolls, in some cases 123 feet long, the temple is Per Amaru itself. It's a book itself. There we can see it's the history book, telling of the history of Kemet. So that's why it was called the books of gates. You're going to see the pylon that is there. There's still there the remains of this ancient city. And even though it's in ruins, it blows our mind. So there, when you look at the structure, all these kings down through the millennials built onto the sacred temple of Ipinasut. Here over 4,000 years ago when it was first started. I try to reconstruct the temple, brothers and sisters, just to give you an idea what was the temple like in its day in terms of when all the structure was there. It had gold and silver. When it talked about Ashurbanipal, we got in the Western world of how Ashurbanipal had all the gold and silver, but where did Ashurbanipal, the Assyrian, where did he get all that gold when he came in and plundered the temples here? This is where Ashurbanipal got his gold from, but although it's in ruins, it still will blow your mind. The great temple, Ipinasut, the most select and holy of places. Here you can put many Vaticans down inside of Ipinasut. The cathedrals of Milan and Rome can all fit comfortably down inside this temple. So we're going back in a procession, just like our ancestors, wearing the white, having a procession going into the most holy temple of our ancestors, Amun, right here, brothers and sisters. We're going to do that tomorrow to honor the great ancestor, to honor the tradition and the ceremonies that our ancestors participated coming into this great temple. Previous groups over the years, as you're passing the ram, the Zoop type for Amun, as you go into the temple. We know that 2,000 years ago, the sun was in the constellation of the ram, facing that great pylon built by that Kushite African, and that is Taharqa. The nave of the Temple of the Lotus are here 79 feet high, brothers and sisters. These are massive structures here. Again, this will blow your mind as well when you walk down between the hypostyle hall of the great columns that our ancestors built. This is the educational center. This is where our ancestors taught the neophytes. This is where one had to go to study for not 4 years, but 40 years. Everywhere you look on the temple, you will see the writing of the Medu-Netcher, the earliest writing known to the world. Some of the things that we do to give you an idea of how massive the columns are, we may ask you to get into a circle. And there you will circle up and see the 33 feet circumference of how massive these temples are at arm's length. And we'll count to see how many people it will take to make the circumference of just one column here. So here we see the 79 feet columns that we'll witness here in the temple and measure just how many of us it will take to complete the whole circle. But what was the purpose? Why did they build these massive lotus columns here? Our ancestors had a science called architectonics. What is architectonics? Architectonics is connecting Mut-Netchet, or Mother Nature, with the building structure, bringing harmony and balance and proportion in terms of the building. So you had an esoteric and exoteric interpretation. What you may see on the outer view, there were still deeper spiritual meanings connected to Mut-Netchet. You see the sun rays coming down. What were they trying to duplicate? So when I was in Uganda, where the Nile starts, and I stood there and I noticed those papyrus swamps, and I said, wow, this is what our ancestors observed from their empirical observation of Mut-Netchet. Here they observed these early papyrus swamps in the beginning of the Nile, and building these columns to express nature and the beginning. I hope you understand how powerful they were in terms of how they built this. So by looking at the papyrus swamps in the beginning of the Nile in Uganda where I was at, then I was able to understand how and why they built these massive structures here. They were trying to duplicate Mut-Netchet. The papyrus swamps or the lotus flowers coming up, because this is the beginning. This is the purpose and the objective of the temple, which is what? Creation, procreation, and renewal. That is the mystery system of life itself. Without creation, procreation, and renewal, there is no life. We are here to procreate for renewal for our children. But out of that, we were created as well. So that is the purpose of the temple. And they saw that in nature itself, creation, procreation, and renewal, where you see the lotus flowers rising up out of the primordial swamps. So they actually duplicated that in the science of architectonics, brothers and sisters, as we see right here.
Look at the clerestory idea, meaning that the grilled gates of the windows. When we look at this closely, the Europeans took from the Temple of Amun, this is where they created the clerestory and the grilled windows, reaching the heights of heavens and putting their images and deifying the white angelical images on the temple, where they copied this idea from the great temples of Ipinasut. This is the clerestory, where it came from, where the light is shining into the temple and ends up in the Western church today. Nobody can deny it. After all, this temple was over 4,000 years ago. Look at the grilled windows, and now let's go back to Africa over 4,000 years ago.
The idea that we look at the church as God's house, it came from here. Here is the temple. The temple was Amun's house on earth. That is the temple of eternity. That is the Netter's place on earth. The story is told that Amun descended from the heavens, brothers and sisters. As you see right here, he's descending from the heavens, coming down into the Ankh-Manu right here. He's descending into heaven. So the Ankh-Manu and the most holy place is the holies of the holies, which all temples have is a holies of the holies, the most holy place in the temple. So when you see this holies of holies, we don't go inside of the holies of holies. We want to respect that which our ancestors respected. Just like if you go on a grave site, you don't go and walk on somebody's grave, even though you don't know them. Is that right? You know that you don't desecrate it. So even though the temple's in ruins, and even though it's thousands of years old, and even though it's been plundered by many armies down through the millennia, we honor that most sacred and holy of places, and that is Amun's Ankh-Manu, or Holies of Holies. When you look at the temple, the whole idea is for Ra, because Ra is a physical representation of Amun, the sun. On the time of the solstice, on the time of the spring and winter solstice, Ra will rise. Here, this Ankh-Manu is different from many others because most Ankh-Manus are closed on both on the back end. But this one's open on both ends for Ra to shine down the temple and down the nave of the temple. To give you an idea, when Ra rises during the time of the summer solstice and winter solstice, here it lights up the whole holies of holies in showing that Amun's presence is with us. This is the prototype of the idea standing there. Here you can see the king stood there with Ra, which hid him. Here we see Menkheperatudime's temple. It will shine through his temple, back to the holies of holies, giving the king or the sultan the divine right to rule the throne. This is powerful in terms of how they connected the solar and the stellar ideas. Here the walls were made of silver and gold. Why? So when Ra would shine down that and come into that Ankh-Manu, it would be like a blast of light. I mean, blast of light coming down that hypostyle hall. So when we look at Amun-Ra, and we're able to have a critical analytical analysis and understanding the spiritual idea of the architecture, now we can see and go to the Vatican. And how did the Vatican get the whole idea of putting the sun down into not only the nave, but in like an Ankh-Manu of their church? Was it not copied from here? It's only until we open our consciousness can we see and see the story that our ancestors told. So the temple of Ipinasut, 2,000 years BCE, thousands of years before the Vatican, but how the Vatican copied from this great temple of the light coming down through the Ankh-Manu. So they call you sun worshipers. Why? They got the sun in the church. In fact, they didn't even see the sun as the center of the solar system. The Inquisitioners would burn you. They thought that it was the earth that was in the center of the solar system. Our ancestors already knew the sun was the center because they aligned the temples with the Ankh-Manu and understood that the sun was in the center of the solar system. So this science that we get from Copernicus, we are told that he is the one that gave us the whole heliocentric idea that the sun was in the center of the solar system, that was already known by Kemetic Africans in the Nile Valley. And then many of these Europeans like Galileo had to repent for this, because if they said, look, the sun is in the center of the solar system, oh, is that right? Well, the church said the earth is in the center of the solar system. So they told them, if you don't take that back, that the sun is in the center of the solar system, we're going to burn you at the stake. They said, oh, nope, the earth is in the center of the solar system. So they didn't even know that This, the sun was in the center of the solar system. They didn't have no spiritual consciousness around Ra.
So as Ra comes down the temple, down that nave, we can see an inscription to the rising sun on Ramesu's pylon. It says, O Ramesu, you behold your father Amun-Ra, the Nesu Neteru. He arises from Ipetasut, illuminating the double doors of the Per house, or the house of Amun-Ra. That means here we see the golden ratio, okay, or the golden circle. It's even in the hypostyle hall of the temple itself, brothers and sisters. There was no Leonardo da Vinci and no Greeks yet when African people were studying this great science of the pi, as they call it, the Greeks call it. But look, I want you to look down the nave of the symbol. Where did they get the symbol from? Where did they get the symbol of the pi from? But your children get Greeks and the deification of Europeans. Where did that pi come from in the golden ratio? Deep down into the ancient temples, brothers and sisters, of sacred knowledge going back thousands of years of the golden ratio, as I showed you, and the universe, the solar system, Mutnechet, nature, everything. Everything is in. And now we are told that the golden circle is in the Vatican to honor Leonardo da Vinci. Thousands of years before the Vatican and Leonardo da Vinci, you had the golden circle right here.
The golden ratio in the tomb of Aptu called Abydos here in Kemet. There we see 3,000 years BCE, they already studied the science of the golden ratio, and you deal with that golden ratio every day when you start to deal with your hair. It's in a golden ratio, but like I said, some of us don't like that golden ratio. Fingerprint itself, your very fingerprint, from the smallest things of Mutnechet or Mother Nature, we see the golden ratio. And they're going to tell you the so-called Fibonacci numbers in nature. But only until you come back here and start studying the science and see the Kemetic Africans have studied this for thousands of years in building all of their temples. These are the Karihebs. And many of you are in various areas of your work, your craft, but many of us do not know the origin of it. Here we see the Karihab priests, also called the Hemneters, who were the servant of Amun, who the temple was dedicated to. The whole education of the Karihab priests, like the Neter Shishatta, the scribe of the holy books, or the holy papyruses, where the holy word was written in ancient Kemet. Priests in various areas of their discipline, just like we have today. Many of us who have gone to school for various things for us to be educated in, here you see the origin of it, like the Karihab Ma'at, priest, judge, and counselors. So, here we see the whole idea of a judge and counselor, attorneys. You may be attorney at law. Here, this is the origin of the attorney of law, ma'at, okay, of judgment, balance, the scribe, okay, of judgment. Karihab Sinu, the pra'ant, the priest doctors of the house of life. When we say doctor, we should try to use an ancient Kemetic word like Sinu. That would be the Kemetic word for doctor. Sinu. So we may go on to be a Sinu in the Pra'ank, or the house of life, that's equivalent to hospitals today. Ipetasut, where the world's first university system came from. Right here in this spiritual center, where over 80,000 students came to go to school here for 40 years. Even the Greeks who came hundreds of years later, also like Thales, Pythagoras, where did they get their order from? Right here.
My sister broke down and cried, who had a PhD in architecture. And I said, sister, why are you crying? She said, I can't believe through my whole educational system to a PhD in architecture that I was never told about this. I was only told about the so-called Roman arches, the composite, the Doric, the Corinthian. This was never taught. Another sister, when we go to the books in stone, to the Pra'ank, the house of life, those of you who are in the medicine, and maybe doctors among us, you're going to see the medical instruments that are still used to this very day on the temple carved in stone. That's the importance of this trip. This is where Pythagoras, where did he get his theorem from? Right here. How can we still have the craft of Pythagoras? How can we be in the lodge still worshiping Pythagoras? Where's Imhotep? Where's Amenhotep, the son of Apu? Where's the Grand Masters? If you're still deifying Pythagoras, if you're still deifying Europeans, if you're still taught to call Alexander, Alexander the Great, you're deifying Europeans. How can our children be told that Eratosthenes gave us the circumference of the earth of 25,000 miles in circumference of the earth, when Inhotep already knew that by studying the winter solstice and the summer solstice? The Greeks came here to go to school. They said they had to cross the burning sands. This is the light of the world.
That's right.
And you've come back, and we are honored that you've come back. So we have to animate. And through the animation, we can see the power of what we're dealing with here. This is Amen's house. The whole idea of the Western world getting the idea of the church, or whether we look at the synagogue or the mosque, this is the prototype. This is the beginning of the spiritual synagogue. So when we think of Catholicism, where is it bases its foundation? From here. These ideas all came from here. When you see King Tutankhamun's tomb and the opening of the mouth ceremony, that's his confessions to Asar, who's going to judge him in the afterlife. But again, you're looking at the books in stone. Spirit is told, and the story is told over and over. Every part of this temple was covered, as you can see. The whole Western Enlightenment that we know about, Newton, Galileo, Copernicus, Kepler, all studied from the manuscripts of the Hermetic texts that came from Tahuti, who the Greeks call Hermes. This was the sacred knowledge. This is how the Western world awakened through Tahuti, the sacred knowledge of ancient Kemet. At high noon, that's when that little scarab starts to fly. So you'll see it on the temple. The scarab beetle flies during the hottest hours of the day, so it's called Kepara. Kepara is transformation. Every time you rise up out of that bed, you have transformed into another point of your life. You've gotten older. Every day you rise, you transform, you go through a Kepara. Yesterday is different. Everything in your body has changed from yesterday. Every time you rise, that's Kepara. In his tomb, you see him, he's coming one with his ka. He's becoming one with Asar. He's coming one with his ka that the Nazis call Kares, that later on the Romans call Christ. There you see in the center of his body, he even has the scarab of the Kepara for his transformation. If it was supposed to be so pagan and heathen, then you tell me, why does the Pope in his garment got a Kepara? This is deep sacred knowledge. The Pope got the Kepara on his garment that was taken from Kemet. That means transformation and resurrection. That goes back thousands of years before the Pope. That's what that symbol is that he's got on his garment. When you look at it closely, the coat of arms, that is the Kepara for resurrection and transformation. These are the secrets. All life is the Kepara, is the transformation. That's why Amenhotep III put that Kepara there. You'll see it in the temple, representing transformation. So when we walk around the scarab, don't say, oh, they're walking around bugs. They're just doing all kinds of things over here. No, it's a symbol of transformation. For those who want to renew vows or even go through marriage and want a child, you walk seven times. One sister made a mistake and got confused what I said. I said, walk three times for your transformation of the things that you want in your life. Well, she misunderstood me and walked seven, and then she went home and got a baby. Things happen like that. You must pay attention on this trip. You must pay attention. Three times for the things that you want to change, what you want to transform in your life. Seven times for a baby. Okay. All right. So again, that's what we will do here. We will walk around Kepara. Kepara, transformation. Ra, the Burdett symbol representing the pineal gland in the brain to bring out the third eye to open up spiritual consciousness. The nectar is protecting the pineal gland with the head, the third eye. 360 degrees, not 33 degrees. That's just a few degrees above freezing. That's 360 degrees of spiritual knowledge and unlocking what? Unlocking the what in the brain? What are they protecting? The pineal gland, brothers and sisters, the seat of the soul. The gold shrine of King Tutankhamun, Ra is rising up and activating his pineal gland. He halts upon his thigh because he met Ra face to face because his pineal gland has been opened. Wait a minute. What? The African spiritual mystery system in the Bible? In Genesis chapter 32, verse 30, and Jacob called the name of the place Peniel, for I have seen God face to face and my life is preserved. Verse 31, and as he passed over Pineal, the sun rose upon him and he halted upon his thigh. Isn't that what you see with King Tutankhamun? As the sun rose upon him
activates his pineal gland. He holds upon his thigh because he met God face to face long before Genesis and Jacob in the Bible. You see the pineal gland in the brain. That's what our ancestors saw the awakening through, the seed of the soul. We understand this spiritual knowledge going back thousands of years. We took it to Asia. Here you see the various chakras rising up, activating the pineal gland. It had nothing to do with no white angels, but the seat of the soul, the pineal gland, brothers and sisters.
Ashra and Mary Rakwesi are lecturers on African history, civilization, religion, and culture. The duo present lively and dynamic presentations and video productions based on their extensive study and travel on the African continent. These national and international lecturers also conduct the annual Kemet Nu Know Thyself educational tours to Egypt and Ethiopia. Brother and Sister Kwesi link the historical with the present by means of visual documentation to bring our story to life. For lectures, videos, audio media, or Egypt and Ethiopia tour brochures, contact Ashra or Mary Rakwesi at Kemet Nu Productions, 214-371-0206. That's 214-371-0206. Or visit www.kemetnu.com. That's KEMETNU.com.